So the format of the session will be each panelist will get an opportunity to make independent speech or presentation for 5-7 minutes in the beginning, and then it will be a panel discussion moderated by Mr. Gautam Samantaji. So over to Mr. Gautam for making the opening remarks of the session, please. Let's welcome this panel with a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.
Basically, as you see, the technology, there is a huge change of what we had seen maybe about 20, 25 years back. You know, mono was the major, the cell and the module technology. But after 2004 and 5, you know, poly was a major, I'll say 80% of the whole, you know, module which has been transformed because of the different casting process and also the cost drivers, you know. So I have a small presentation, so I'll go through it, you know. In the PV value chain, you know, as you know, the crystalline silicon has taken a major share of it, you know, compared to the other technology. I'll go through the other technology as well, you know. But silicon, the material itself, you know, by itself, you know, because of second abundant material in the earth, you know, which is 18.3%, you know. And through the research in the Bell's laboratory in 1954, basically, this is for the space research organizations, you know. So the material has been, you know, quite matured, and the silicon is a very stable compound. It doesn't change its compositions as well, you know. So we'll see in the value chains how the, you know, in the raw material side, you know, which come into the polysilicon. You know, polysilicon is the material coming from the metallurgical grade silicon. Before that is the sand, you know. So from the sand to metallurgical grade silicons, you know, where the cost is almost $1 a kilo, and when you make a polysilicon, something like $14 to $15 a kilo in the value on that, you know, and then you prepare an ingot. This ingot may be done in the two way. One is the casting method through the poly. The another for mono is called the Jokrolski's method, and then you dice the wafer into a slicing with a 200 micron and industry standard like 156 by 156 millimeter. And there are two type, you know, this the photo, what is over here is called a pseudo square, and then there's the installation. So in the technology tree, for the first of all, the crystalline silicon is that the poly and the mono. Poly means it is a perfect square, you know, 156 by 156 millimeter. And today the technology has changed, you know, like everybody is talking like the multi bus bar. You know, three bus bar is no more in the production today in China, or there in India, maybe one or two companies is running, you know. But 4 to 5 bus bar, or sometimes is now it's a 6 bus bar, you know. So there is a technology now, bus bar free module, cell and module both are coming, you know. On the right hand side, this is a mono, which is called a pseudo square. And in the poly on the left side, you know, the standard is called aluminium BSA process, and the device point of view, you know, it's a poly device, you know, with the standard P-type, and then you make a surface cleaning through the etching, create a kind of a small micro pyramids for the light arrest. And then after that, you create a kind of anti-reflection on the front side. On the back side is a aluminium, which is acting as a P-plus, you know, the positive on the rear side, you know. So rear side is always positive, and front side is a negative side, you know. And there are PERC technology with the poly. On the right-hand side, you know, there are both P-type and the N-type. You know, P-type, N-type means P is the positive charge carrier is the majority, or N-type is the negative charge carrier in the majority, you know. So there is also the technology like the PERC, as well as a part bifacial, as well as there is a one more technology which has come, is a part bifacial, but I'll show you in the applications level, you know. On the thin film side, you know, there is a another one is a silicon thin film, which is also come like a single junctions, you know. In the history, like in the Mozambique, you know, about 10 years back, we put a amorphous silicon plant with a very low efficiency, around 7 to 7.5%, you know. So that time that technology was there, and it may be in a double junction, it may be a triple junction. For triple junction is a tandem cells, you know, we can enhance the efficiency around 11 to 12%. Maybe 13%, depending on the kind of a, you know, the device structure, you know. We'll go through very quickly. The cadmium telluride is one of the most popular company in the world, is a First Solar, you know, they are using this cadmium. But you have to see the material availability in the earth, you know. I mean, you can increase the volume of the productions, but the availability of the material is also another concern. Plus, the material as an element like cadmium and tellurium is a very toxic, you know. The post-module disposals is also another issue, you know. You have to look into those environmental point of view, you know. The another is the CIGS is a one of the first and the foremost company in Japan is called the Solar Frontier. You know, they have a patented technology and almost the capacity like 1.5 gigawatt. So in the generations, you know, if you see the optical, you know, overall the quantum of the spectrum from the generations point of view, cadmium telluride, CIGS technology is one of the best technology in the world, but the availability and also the cost, you know, we have to see when we make a kind of power plant, the cost is the main factor why we have to take into the consideration, not the generation as well, you know. So we talk about the LCOE, levelized cost of electricity. Triple junction cells, this is a gallium arsenide based, you know. Today, anybody in the space shuttle, you know, whatever the kind of the cells, you know, that is sending over there, you know, these are called the gallium arsenide based cells, you know, like Spectralab or Boeing, you know, this is over 40%, you know, this is also obviously a triple junctions, you know, over 40% of the efficiency of this kind of a cell, you know. Okay, coming back to the polysilicon consumptions, you know, so if we look into the polysilicon consumptions, maybe in by 2015, like 5.2 gram, you know, per watt is a kind of a consumption, but today it is now reducing because of the improvement in the efficiency of the cell, you know. So efficiency means, say for example, in a thumb rule, like in per square meter, the sun intensity which is coming is 1,000 watt per square meter, you know. So if your panel is 2 square meter, you know, so if it generates say 200, you know, watt, you know, so something like 20% is the efficiency, you know. So something like here also the silicon consumptions that we take into the considerations. In the roadmap, there are several things, you know, which I have already told, you know, there is a technology is called the heterojunction intrinsic thin layer, you know. This is the N-type material and the company called Sanyo, but today Sanyo has been taken over by Panasonic, you know. This is a patented technology, you know. They are in mass productions over 21% efficiency, bifacial N-part. Another company which is called Interdigitated Back Contact is a Sun Power Corporation in the USA. They have a patented technology. Obviously, it is the N-type of mono cells, you know. And there is other type cells like the PRC. This is the most common for any Chinese manufacturers as well as the Indian is also following. So compared to the conventional, the which is called the aluminum BSF with the PRT cell, this is a device configurations level that we have seen, you know. Basically, when you are making a PRC cells, you know, on the rear side is also passivated. But these passivations to get a junction, there is a lot of laser holes to be there, you know, to get a metal contact, you know, to have a minimum series resistance. So that kind of thing, you know, over here we have shown. N-type mono IBC, you know, we know Sun Power is a patented about maybe 20 years back, you know. Professor Richard Swanson, you know, he was the main inventor from the IC technology. It has developed into a interdigitated back contact technology, you know. So on the rear side, if you see these are negative, then there is a positive, negative, positive, you know. But on the rear side, all the negative are connected in one bus bar and all the positive are connected in a one bus bar. So this cell is nothing but a small module as in a totality, you know. So there is a company in China who is there, they are also making like 25.04%, you know, it has been checked by a JET laboratory, you know, efficiency. And then there's a new technology is coming about, you know, how to make a very high efficiency cell, you know. So calcium titanate is a kind of a structure, you know, in the crystallography you have seen, you know. And they want to do a different kind of a device structure to have the maximum, you know, efficiency in the quantum level. HGCT, what I have already told, you know, in the device level, we can discuss in a minute, later stage, you know, in a 1:1, you know, about the device structures and how the things are working here. In the module level now, from the cell, obviously, is a bus bar free, you know, only the fingers. These fingers are nothing but it can collect the electron, you know, to the nearest, the bus bar, nearest, I'll say, the grid pattern here, but it is a completely a bus bar free, you know. So bus bars will be a kind of a thing, you know, which is perpendicular to the wire, you know, you can have a wire mesh like that, you know. So from this configurations, what will have a minimum resistance but maximum output from this, you know, device point of view. And there is a one more is called the half cut cell. You know, there is a company in Singapore called REC Corporations. You know, they are working on a half cut cell. If you have a, you know, full cell and if you cut it, and then what you will have, you know, you will have a, at least 5% of your power output will be increased because of the isolations, because junction isolations, you know. So therefore, the series resistance will be reduced and fill factor will be in, I mean, improved, and thereon, therefore, you know, you have seen in this figure, you know, how from the 77.5% to 79%. But in a module, what you will get, like a conventional module, you get a negative and the positive polarity with a, if it is a, you know, 72 cells configurations, you get something like 345 to 350 watt modules, you know. So you don't bother about the inside, what is there, you know, how it is laminated, how it is cell had been, you know, done, you know. Now, the glass-to-glass is also a conventional, compared to the conventional technology, because, you know, everybody is now switching over to 1500 volt, you know, a module, you know. So if you have a glass-to-glass of the laminations, you know, by default, it will work not only if 1500 volt, but if there is a micro crack, you know, in a conventional module, in a, means with a Tedlar base, but here, even there is a micro crack, and through the thermal cycling, you know, IEC 61215, if you take two times or three times IC test on the thermal cycling, damp free time, humidity freeze, you know, the separations is not that prominent. That means is this module is going to last not only 25 years, it's a 30 years module compared to the your Tedlar based module, you know? So there is a kind of a lot of advantage and disadvantage we can discuss later on, you know. And transportation, this kind of a module with a glass is an issue, but it has been resolved. But moreover, the installations has been in a different form, you know, how to mount, you know, this kind of a module. You know, there are different configurations that we can work out with the minimum, you know, the cost in the mounting structures without sacrificing the wind load. I mean, I'm talking about the dynamic load, you know, in a very high wind speed where 80 kilometer per hour or 100 kilometer per hour, okay? The last but most important part is that the bifacial module, you know, bifacial is a thing, you know, this is an N-type module. In the front side it will generate, and also on the rear side, you know. So bifacial module, what happens, this is a one junction, that means the diode, I mean, it is acting as a diode, the voltage is fixed, but because of the exposure of the front on the back side, you know, you increase your current. So therefore, to increase the current, what does it do? There is an albedo effect, you know, from the rear side, you know. So there are different installations, like one is called the fixed installations, and there is a, like a, on the back side is a white reflecting surface. It can be vertically, you know, installed, or it can be done nowadays, you know, there is a things, you know, which is very much in the configurations here, because this kind of a, you know, water-based, you know, wherever there is a lake or anywhere, you know, these modules will work not only for 25 to 30 years, but it will also generate extra electricity because of the reflection from the water, you know. So there are several summaries on that, you know. I have done some research on that, you know, particularly at what angles and particularly at what in the cloudy conditions as well, you know, how the bifacial module work with the, with at what angles, you know. So that is a generation point of view here with the white, you know, there is a painting, but this is a fixed tilt, you know. If you have a with a, I mean, tracker, you can generate at least 10% more than conventional this one, you know. Okay, another important thing is that AC-based module, if there is a micro inverter, you know, on the back side of the junction box that you can create directly from the DC, because the module is itself is a DC power, you know. You can convert it from the DC to AC, you know. So that's all. Thank you very much. You know. Inverter side, or maybe how we can improve the future installations, is not only a cost effective, but the looking into the technology like 1500 volt and string inverter, as well as the utility scale in the ground mounted systems, you know, with the conventional things, and how we can improve the performance and make a very cost effective solutions to have, you know, another 80 gigawatt to come another by the 5 years time, you know. So in the roadmap, what is your company Huaye is doing, you know?
Thank you very much, sir. So first of all, I would like to say thanks to all of you. And after the lunch sessions are already always tough, but yeah, we will keep you awake. We will have this discussion better. Says Gautam sir has enlightened us with a lot of good technology, lot of good information about modules, and even I come from the module background, but for me also revising everything was really good. So today I'm representing Huawei. Huawei is a telecommunication company, is in ICT technologies in last 30 years, and we entered in the solar business in 2007. And currently, last 3-4 years, we are only focusing on string solution. So what Huawei has done 4 years back, they thought of what could be the new technology which can shape the industry of the market. Can we really turn up something? So they did a comparison between central and string, and they found out that the future is going to be the string inverters. They did a comparison that only challenge is the scale and the cost optimization. So Huawei scaled up the manufacturing, and in 2015 we did 10 gigawatt shipment, and 2016 20 gigawatt, 2017 30 gigawatt. By this we are able to shape the industry in a different direction. Just 2 years back when Huawei was trying to enter in India market, that a lot of developers have the perception that India market is not suitable for the string inverter, but we had a different thought. We met the developer, we tried to have reasoning with them, and we explained the value propositions of the string solutions. And now, in 1 year, 1.5 years of the time, we did 2 gigawatt shipment to India. And what was the main reasons for that? So people asked me, who are not aware of the string technology. So I said that string technology was always there. In the first 5 megawatt Kimser plant white lines was all with the string inverters. The only problem was that we could not catch up with the cost optimization. Now, coming back to the technology part, the few benefits of the having small inverters spread among the solar field. One of the major one is the multiple MPPT. When I talk about the multiple MPPT for a comparison, let's say for a 5 megawatt or 6 megawatt AC block size, now. For let's say you consider 1 megawatt central inverter, you'll have 4 MPPTs for managing 5 megawatt AC plant. And if you go for 2 megawatt central block, you'll have only 2 MPPT managing so many strings. Now what happens, every string, every module has a different characteristics. They behave differently. No matter how much the companies claim, but there will be some difference. And by that time, after a year or 1.5 years, the performance will also again change. Now if think about a case that every 2 strings will have 1 MPPT to manage, then it will give you a yield, more yield than around 2%. So that's the benefit from the having these string inverters. Now I'll come to the point that what Huawei is doing new about the industry, that we have implemented some new features like smart IV curve. So we were already doing the monitoring of current and voltage. So we had the idea what we can do with it. You know, everyone is having combiner boxes monitoring current and voltage, but what's happening with that data which is getting collected? So why not to put some algorithm, some software, who can basically plot an IV curve and keep an history of it. Like say you install a solar power plant today, and you have the IV curve, you put that module data and the string data into the software, then you can compare the IV curves over a period of time, let's say after 6 months, 1 year, 2 year, and there's a degradation which you can notice. The system we have designed in such a way that algorithm will tell you that if there's a slight change in the IV curve, you will be able to know that there's a problem of hotspot or shading, the module crack or junction box failure. So within the minutes you will know, let's say you have a 500 megawatt plant, you cannot just go and check each and every module. But these kinds of technology can give you the answers. Sitting in a room in Delhi, you know that out of your 500 megawatt plant, 1% strings are not working fine because of so-and-so reason. That's one. And some more things, new technologies coming about 1500 volt. And 1500 volt, the only challenge was the balance of the system. The balance of the system was not ready. It's about the protection and the cables. Now the developers are thinking about it, and they are putting up solar power plant. And some of the developers are only talking about 1500 volt because they know that the supply chain has geared up, the companies have come up with a new solution of higher voltage, and new safety measures have been taken. So I also see this is going to be the future, that in 6 months from now, we will only see the plants with 1500 volt solutions. So this is some new technology I've shared. I will hand it over to Gautam sir again.
Thank you, Mayank. Thank you very much. Now I will ask Mr. Amresh Mahajan, who is a most experienced person in the industry, you know, who has spent several years in the factory, you know, on the quality, and he's also now in a big role in the Acme Solar, you know. We will ask his series experience, you know, about the future installations, what is the kind of the challenge with the new technology in the module, or whatever way that you can add value, because ultimately we have to achieve a very low cost, you know, something like 2 rupees 50 paise, you know, average figure of electricity, you know, so which is called the levelized cost of electricity. How to achieve those things, you know, if you can throw some light, you know, through the technology and the quality.
Thank you, Gautam sir. Good afternoon, everyone. So before I answer Gautam sir's question, so let me take you through what ACME does and what I represent. We've been only EPC player, then I think the price of the tariff would matter a lot. But since we have the intention of keeping the plant for 25 years, then quality is equally important. So how it will come in next 25 years, I mean, how with tariffs coming down, how the plants will behave in next 25 years. So that is a big concern for all the developers, both from the pricing point of view, as well as from the point of view of how the modules will behave or how the generation will happen in next 25 years. So the first part is how the technological growth is taking place. So as he has explained very rightly in his presentation, for example, if we take only the crystalline modules, so for both mono and poly, if we take if we go 5 years down the line or 6 years down the line, there was conventional poly module which was having a wattage of around 200-210 watt for a 60 cell module, and for mono it used to be 220 watts. So the journey from 200 watt to 270 to 80 watt has taken around 4 to 5 years, and the outlook for next 4 or 5 years, again for 60 cell we plan to touch 300 or 310, and simultaneously for 72 cell we plan to touch 400 420. So primarily the developments that have taken place is, for example, what he has mentioned, the bus bar growth from 2 to 5 6, and multi bus bar people are talking about 12 and actually manufacturing it. Then the PERC technology, glass to glass, cut cell, n-type mono, there's so many other factors which have actually graduated the power from a particular level to the current level. How ACME or any other developer who is also price conscious is going to take this? This question is actually for the entire industry to see and then answer. For example, I'll take an example that from a simple mono to mono PERC, the wattage change is close to 20 watts. Now, if that 20 watts more power in a particular module, that will have a saving in land cost and the balance of system cost. That turns out to be close to 3 or 4%. But unfortunately, what is happening today is the premium asked by the module manufacturers for graduating from, say, 340 watt to 355 or 360 watt is more than 4%. So if the technology is to help developers in India from the power increase or the wattage increase, then each and every technological gain has to be offsetted by the saving in the balance of the system. If the manufacturer asks for premium for that, then probably the new technological things is not going to happen in India for maybe next few years. People are going to, you know, still keep on buying the conventional modules. So like I said, so many things are happening, the glass to glass, the LRF technology, the PERC, but the consumption in India is very, very less. Not because it is unavailable in the market, but because it is expensive. The developers like us want to take that. In fact, ECME was the first developer to try out a very different technology, N-type mono. We have a 7 megawatt power plant in south. But still, that was more to study the waters, more to study the market. However, to have this all these flavors in our portfolio, that would require each and every percentage gain in power to be offsetted by the gain we get in reducing the balance of system or the land cost. That way, the manufacturers like Longi or whosoever is making the modules, they have to help by passing on the benefit of that technology to the developers. If that happens, that will be a win-win situation for everyone. If it doesn't happen, then what I see is the newer technologies will enter Indian market, but after a very long time, probably at the fag end of their lives. And this has been happening in India for last 4 or 5 years. Each and every technology enters very, very late. This is one part. The second part is, I again refer to this point very frequently in various forums, what I feel is the current standards, it's 61215 or 61730, whatever it is, unfortunately, they have been designed keeping in mind the cold weather conditions, like for Europe, for China, for America. But for very hot and humid countries like India, these standards, in my view, are not very relevant. You can ask a manufacturer, he will say, okay, it has passed 61215 and he will sell the modules to you. But unfortunately, our conditions are very, very different. People in isolation have tried out various trials, various tests to see whether they whether these modules will perform in market for 25 years or not. But on an overall scale, there needs to be something from maybe Indian industry, maybe from the government side, or maybe from the IEC also. They should also consider that India is a big market, and they should have something in this standards which actually take care of this this geographical change in hot and humid countries like India. So if these two things are happening, one, manufacturer passing the wattage gain in terms of monetary terms to the developers, and second, the agencies like IEC or the Indian government, they make the standards in such a way that it enhances the life of modules in India, then I think it's the way forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Amresh. For your information, ECME is the first developer company who has got their own in-house laboratory to check the module performance and also do some sort of a reliability testing, you know. If the module is maybe after 5 years is performing or not, you know. So it's not only that, they have also installed the first in India by the bifacial module, you know. So it is a pilot project like 7 megawatt, but that will give a lot of generations as well as informations for the country as well, you know, to have the confidence for the future, you know. So I will ask, there will be presentations from the our three panelists, you know. I will ask first, Mr. Praveen G, you know, Praveen Handa from the, you know, from DuPont, you know, one of the old laboratory in US, you know, more than 150 years old. So they are basically material manufacturers and also shown a path, you know, how to use the different the polymers in the module and what will be the reliability of this module for the future, maybe after 25 years, and how the module will last, you know. So he will give explanations on that, you know, through these presentations.
Good afternoon, friends, and